Hello viewers, this is Ranjana ma'am and you are watching not mine, your channel. And yes, you must be having grievances. Oh, ma'am is only putting up videos for ICSE. What about us? Yes, so I've got quite a few requests regarding quality. So here I am. Quality is a bit difficult, but still, it's a nice story. And before we start it, again, I would like to ask you to subscribe to my channel if you have not subscribed up till now. And watch the full video and do press the like button if you have liked my video. So I go on uttering like a parrot, but the responses are not really very good. I'm expecting better. Anyway, we should do the work, not expect returns. Try to do the good work and not expect returns. That is what the Gita says. God is there to reward me. That Browning's faith. Anyway, jokes apart, let's start it. So, Quality by John Galsworthy, and I always say that it's better to read from the box. So, the last paragraph. In the narrative story Quality, published in 1912, Galsworthy poses the issue of the hardships that true artists have to face in a shallow, money-mad world that attaches little importance to the ideals of quality and excellence here. Yes, that is very true. Quality is now being undermined. These commercial, what should we say, commercial farms are taking over, like, and quality is being replaced with quantity. Rather, the more you produce, you'll get more customers. And you make something in 15 days, no one will come to you. So quality is losing its importance in today's world. If a thing is really of good quality, it will last you a long time. So in the past, if a thing was made, people always valued quality. But now it is like lico pico and use and throw. So no one is going for quality because, oh, it's quite attractive. I'll go for it. Arey, it doesn't last. Who cares? I'll use it for maybe a year and after that, I'll go for something which is in vogue, which is in style. New fashion. So in the olden times, someone bought a watch and it would go for three generations. And now though every year maybe they are buying watches. Use it and then throw it. Oh, this is not in style. New, something new has come. So quality has lost its significance in today's world. I knew him from the days of my extreme youth. Who is this him? Because he made my father's boots. So he is the shoemaker. Inhabiting with his elder brother, two little shops let into one in a small by street. Now no more, but then most fashionably placed in the West End. So the author is going back into his childhood days, talking of the past, that since he was from his extreme youth, he knew this shoemaker who would make his father's boots, and he stayed with his elder brother. Two little shops joined into one in a small by street. It doesn't exist anymore, that shop, but it was there. That time it was quite a famous shop. That tenement had a certain quiet distinction. There was no sign upon its face that he made for any royal family. So he did not advertise, oh, we make for the royal shoes for the royal family. Nothing like that. Merely his own German name of Gessler Brothers. So this was the signboard, Gessler Brothers. And in the window, a few pairs of boots. A few pairs of boots were hanging as specimen. I remember that it always troubled me to account for those unwearing boots in the window, for he made only what was ordered, reaching nothing down, and it seemed so inconceivable that what he made could ever have failed to fit. So he was always worried whose boots are these, because he always made shoes when they were ordered. So these boots are here. Does he keep it here because it has not fitted a particular client, customer? But it can't be so. So whose boots are there? That too seemed, had he bought them to put there? So did he buy these only to put them there? No, that also is not. He wouldn't buy other people's shoes made by other people. He would never have tolerated in his house leather on which he had not worked himself. So he was a very fastidious person. He would always buy the leather himself with which he would make shoes. Besides, they were too beautiful, the pair of pumps, so inexpressibly slim, the patent leathers with cloth tops, making water come into one's mouth. Money, they were so attractive as if your mouth would water. They are nothing edible, but still. The tall brown riding boots with marvelous sooty glow, as if, though new, they had been worn 100 years. Those pairs could only have been made by one who saw before him the soul of boot. So boot is as if being personified. So truly were they prototypes incarnating the very spirit of all footgear. So as if the maker had instilled the soul of the boot in these boots. Not just boots, the soul of the boot. These thoughts, of course, came to me later. Though even when I was promoted to him at the age of perhaps 14, so he did not make shoes for children. When the author or the narrator was 14 years, then only he was taken to Gessler Brothers to get his shoes made. Some inkling haunted me of the dignity of himself and brother, for to make boots, such boots as he made, seemed to me then and still seems to me mysterious and wonderful. How could he do it so wonderfully? It's strange. It's a mystery. I remember well my shy remark one day while stretching out to him my youthful foot. So he was a bit shy. He stretched out his foot. Isn't it awfully hard to do, Mr. Gessler? And his answer given with a sudden smile from out of the sardonic redness of his beard. It is an art. He means to say it is an art, but it's the German accent. It is an art. Himself, he was little as if made from leather. With his yellow, crinkly face, so the narrator feels he looks as if he himself is also made of leather. With his yellow, crinkly face and crinkly reddish hair and beard and neat folds slanting down his cheeks to the corner of his mouth. And his guttural one-toned voice. For leather is a sardonic substance and stiff and slow of purpose. So he's as if like leather. And that was the character of his face, save that of his eyes, which were grey-blue. So the eyes were grey-blue. Had in them the simple gravity of one secretly possessed by the ideal. What ideal? Ideal of quality, maintaining quality. His elder brother also was so very like him, though watery, paler in every way with a great industry, that sometimes in early days I was not quite sure of him until the interview was over. So they seemed very alike each other, only this brother was paler than the younger brother. Younger brother was more in command. The elder brother was more subservient. But they seemed very similar. Then I knew that it was he, if the words, I will ask my brother. So the elder brother never said anything on his own. He would always say, I will ask my brother. And when this was said, the narrator realized, oh, so this was the elder brother I was talking to, not younger one. That if they had, it was his elder brother. When one grew old and wild and ran up bills, one somehow never ran them up with Gessler Brothers. It would not have seemed becoming to go in there and stretch out one's foot to that blue iron spectacle glance, owing him for more than, say, two pairs. Just the comfortable reassurance that one was still his client. Yeah, When you are when you grow old and wild, you get into bills, money. You start getting into money, money. You run into bills, but you don't run bills in Gessler Brothers. Why? Because there his shoes lasted a long time, and his shoes might be expensive because it was made of the finest quality leather, but they lasted a long time. So at the most, you make two pairs of shoes just to assure him that I'm still your client. For it was not possible to go to him very often. His boots lasted terribly, having something beyond the temporary, some, as it were, essence of boots stitched into them. One went in, not as into most shops, in the mood of please serve me and let me go. This is how you enter a shop, but here you didn't enter in that way, but restfully, as one enters a church. When you enter a church, now you enter with a lot of respect, silently, the somber atmosphere. His shop was like that, sitting on the single wooden chair, waited for there was never anybody there. Soon, over the top edge of that sort of well, rather dark and smelling soothingly of leather, which formed the shop, there would be seen his face. So he would come down the stairs. From the top, he would peep, and then he would come down. Or that of his elder brother peering down. A guttural sound and the tip-tap of the bass slippers beating the narrow wooden stairs, and he would stand before one without coat, a little bent in leather apron. That means that is his workshop and he was working there. And on knowing that a customer has come, he would peep, he would inquire, and then he would come down, blinking as if awakened from some dream of boots, or like an owl surprised in daylight and annoyed at this interruption. So here is a simile. He is compared to an owl. Owls are nocturnal creatures, so in the day they find it difficult to see. And I would say, how do you do, Mr. Gessler? Could you make a pair of Russia leather boots? Without a word, he would leave me, retiring whence he came. So he would go again back and then come down, or into the other portion of the shop, and I would continue to rest in the wooden chair, inhaling the incense of his trade. What is the incense of his trade? The leather, the scent of leather. Soon he would come back, holding in his thin veined hand a piece of gold brown leather. With eyes fixed on it, he would remark, "What a beautiful piece." Piece is actually piece. When I too had admired it, he would speak again, "When do you want them?" And when do you want them? And I would answer, "Oh, as soon as you conveniently can." And he would say, "Tomorrow, fortnight," means a fortnight from tomorrow. Or if it was his elder brother, "I will ask my brother." Then I would murmur, "Thank you. Good evening, Mr. Gessler." Good morning, Mr. Gessler. Good morning," he would reply, still looking at the leather in his hand. And as I moved to the door, I would hear the tip-tap of his bass slippers. So he's again going up the stairs to dream of his boots. But if it were some new kind of footgear that he had not yet made, then indeed he would observe ceremony, divesting me of my boot and holding it long in his hand, looking at it with eyes at once critical and loving, as if recalling the glow with which he had created it and rebuking the way in which one had disorganized this masterpiece. So, yes, he would take out the shoes of the narrator. He would observe it very lovingly because it was also made by him. And he would look at it lovingly but disapprove of the way it has been used. Then, placing my foot on a piece of paper, he would two or three times tickle the outer edge. He would take a fresh measurement with a pencil and pass his nervous fingers over my toes, feeling himself into the heart of my requirements. I cannot forget that day on which I had the occasion to say to him, "Mr. Gessler, that last pair of town walking boots creaked. You know, it made a creaking noise." My God, he's telling this to the master shoemaker. He looked at me for a time without replying, as if it could not be, he could not take it, as if expecting me to withdraw or qualify the statement, then said, "It should not have creaked." It should not have creaked. It did, I'm afraid. You got them wet before they found themselves? I don't think so. At this, he lowered his eyes as if hunting for memory of those boots. Man, he's trying to remember those boots. And I felt sorry. I had mentioned this grave thing. He feels, why did I have to tell him all this? Send them back, he said. I will look at them. Send them back. I will look at them. A feeling of compassion for my creaking boots surged up in me. So well could I imagine the sorrowful long curiosity of regard which he would bend on them. So he knows, oh my God, how sorrowfully he would bend on them to find why it made a creaking sound. Some boots, he said slowly, are bad from birth. If I can do nothing with them, I take them off your will, off your bill. So he says some boots are like that right from the beginning, from their birth only they are bad. So if I cannot stop that creaking sound, you don't have to pay for it. Once I went absent-mindedly into his shop in a pair of boots bought in an emergency at some large firms. He took my order without showing me any leather, and I could feel his eyes penetrating the inferior integument of my foot. So he didn't bring the leather to show him, and he is not happy with this. He's trying to watch the boots the narrator is wearing because these are not made by him. At last he said, those are not my boots. The tone was not of anger, nor of sorrow, not even of contempt, but there was in it something quiet that froze the blood. He put his hand down, pressed a finger on the place where the left boot, endeavoring to be fashionable, was not quite comfortable. Yeah, sometimes for the sake of fashion, they sacrifice comfort. It hurts you there. See what a master shoemaker he is. He knows it hurts him there. Those big firms have no self-respect. Trash. So those big firms have no self-respect. Trash. And then as if something had given way within him, he spoke long and bitterly. It was the only time I ever heard him discuss the condition and hardships of his trade. The firms, they'll produce in large numbers. And people, they will get the shoes whenever they want. They won't have to wait a fortnight as they have to do in Gessler's. And Gessler's, since they were leather of the best quality, they would be expensive. So people would think, why should we buy from him? We would go to the shop and get them, or to the farms and get them. They get it all. They get it by advertisement, not by word. So they get it through advertisement, not because of their work. They take it away from us who loaf our boots. We love our boots, but they take it away from us. It comes to this. Presently, I have no work. It has come to this that I have no work. These farms have taken away all my work. Every year it gets less, you will see. Yeah, with the passing of years, the orders are deteriorating in number, decreasing. And looking at his lined face, I saw things I had never noticed before, bitter things and bitter struggle. And what a lot of grey has there suddenly seemed in his red beard. So he is aging up. As best as I could, I explained the circumstances of the purchase of those ill-omened boots. So he's trying his best to tell Mr. Gessler why he had bought these boots. But his face and voice made so deep an impression that during the next few minutes, I ordered many pairs. It is as if to compensate for having bought that boot from someone else. He gives quite a few orders. Nemesis fell. They lasted more terribly than ever. And I was not able conscientiously to go to him for nearly 2 years. The shoes were so durable that for 2 years he didn't need any shoes. When at last I went, I was surprised to find that outside one of the two little windows of his shop, another name was painted. Also that of a bootmaker, making of course for the royal family. So here was advertisement. So the shop has been again split. One half has been given up. And here another shoemaker has taken it as, has become its tenant. And he is advertising, we make shoes for the royal family. The old familiar boots, no longer in dignified isolation, were huddled in the single window belonging to the Gessler brothers. So the shop again divided. Inside the now contracted well of one little shop was more scented and darker than ever. And it was longer than usual too before a face peered down and the tick-tap of the bus slippers began. At last he stood before me, and gazing through those rusty iron spectacles, he said, "Mr. Isn't it?" "Ah, Mr. Gessler," I stammered, "but your boots are really too good, you know. See, they are quite decent still." He's trying to show his boots. "They are still quite decent." And I stretched out to him my foot. He looked at it. "Yes, people do not want good boots, it seems." To get away from his reproachful eyes and voice, I hastily remarked, "What have you done to your shop?" He answered quietly, "It was too expensive." "Do you want some boots?" "It was too expensive." "Do you need any more boots?" "I ordered 3 pairs, though I had wanted 2, and quickly left. I do not know quite what feeling of being part in his mind of a conspiracy against him, or not perhaps so much against him as against his idea of boot. Mane, he said, it has lasted me more than 2 years, so he says, no one wants good boots now. One does not, I suppose, care to feel like that, for it was again many months before my next visit to his shop paid, I remember with a feeling, "Oh, well, I can't leave the old boy, so here goes. Yeah, he can't leave this old man now. This man is struggling for survival. Perhaps it will be his, he just wishes, I hope it's his elder brother. Please, 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 may it be the elder brother who comes to meet me, because he feels he can't face this man. For his elder brother, I knew, had not the character enough to reproach me, handling a piece of leather. "Well, Mr. Gessler," I said, "how are you?" He came close and peered at me. "I'm pretty well," he said, "but my elder brother is dead." And I saw that it was indeed himself. But how aged and wan. So when he had entered the shop, he thought it was his elder brother. But no, it was not the elder brother. It was the younger brother who has aged so much that he looks as if he's the elder one. And the elder brother is already dead. "Yes, much shocked, I murmured, "Oh, I'm sorry." "Yes," he answered, "he was a good man. He made good wood. But he's dead." And he touched the top of his head, where the hair had suddenly gone as thin as it had been on that of his poor brother, to indicate, I suppose, the cause of death. He could not get over losing the other shop. "Do you want any boots?" So yes, the losing of the other shop had affected the elder brother so much. That was the reason for his death. "Do you want any boots?" And he held up the leather in his hands. "It's a beautiful piece. I ordered several pairs. It was very long before they came. But they were better than ever. One simply could not wear them out. And soon after that, I went abroad. It was over a year before I was again in London. And the first shop I went was to my old friend's, Gessler. I'd left a man of 60, I came back to one of 75. That means within that 1 year, he has aged as if 15 years. Pinched and worn and tremulous, he's shaking. Who genuinely this time did not first know me. "Oh, Mr. Gessler," I said, sick at heart, "how splendid your boots are. See, I've been wearing this pair nearly all the time I've been abroad. And they are not half worn out, are they?" He looked long at my boots, a pair of Russia leather, and his face seemed to regain steadiness. Putting his hand on my instep, he said, "Do they fit you here? I had trouble with that pair, I remember. So do they fit you here?" "I had trouble with that pair, I remember." I assured him that they fitted beautifully. "Do you want any boots? I can make them quickly. It is a slack time. So if you want shoes, I can make them faster because I don't have any other order in hand. It's a slack time." I answered, "Please, please, I want boots all around, every kind." Actually, why is he ordering so much? It is only to help this man. He sees this man is really on the verge of starvation. "I will make a fresh model. Your foot must be bigger." And with utter slowness, so he will have to take a fresh measurement because the foot must have grown. And with utter slowness, he traced round my foot and felt my toes, only once looking up to say, "Did I tell you my brother was dead?" So last time only he had told. To watch him was painful, so feeble had he grown. I was glad to get away. I had given those boots up, so he had given up the thought of those boots coming only. When one evening they came, I opening the parcel, I set the four pairs, so he had ordered four pairs in a row. Then one by one, I tried them on. There was no doubt about it. In shape and fit, in finish and quality of labor, they were the best he had ever made. So, though he is aged, his quality, he makes no compromise with quality. His quality is not affected. And in the mouth of one of the town walking boots, I found his bill. The amount was the same as usual, but it gave me quite a shock. He had never before sent it in till quarter day. So why does he send it with the shoes? That means he must be in utter need of money. I flew downstairs and wrote a check and posted it at once with my own hand, immediately. So he understands this man must be in need of money. A week later, passing the little street, I thought I would go in and tell him how splendidly the new boots fitted. But when I came to where his shop had been, his name was gone. No more Gessler Brothers. Still there in the window were the slim pumps, the patent leathers with cloth tops, and the sooty riding boots. The shoes were there for display, but the Gessler brother name was not there. I went in very much disturbed. In the two little shops, again made into one. So the one who had purchased the other one, he has taken this one also and again clubbed the two. Was a young man with an English face. "Mr. Gesslerin," I said. He gave me a strange, ingratiating look. "No, sir," he said, "no, but we can attend to anything with pleasure. We've taken the shop over. You've seen our name, no doubt, next door. We make for some very good people." Advertisement. "Yes, yes," I said, "but Mr. Gessler?" "Oh," he answered, "dead." "Dead? But I only received these boots from him last Wednesday week." "Ah," he said, "a shocking go. Poor old man starved himself." "Good God." "Slow starvation, the doctor called it. You see, he went to work in such a way." Yeah. So he worked in such a way, na, he would be busy with his shoes, never giving time to eat or sleep. Would keep the shop on, wouldn't have a soul touch his boots except himself. So he would be the sole person to work on his boots. No help, nothing. When he got an order, it took him such a time. People won't wait. He lost everybody. And there he would sit, going on and on. I will say that for him. Not a man in London made a better boot. But look at the competition. He never advertised. Would have the best leather too and do it all himself. Well, there it is. What could you expect with his idea? So you have to change with the time. This is what the man is suggesting. But that man, Gessler, he made no compromise. No compromise with quality. I will give my best, even if it takes time. Even if I don't get orders. But starvation, that may be a bit flowery, as the saying is. But I know myself, he was sitting over his boots day and night to the very last. You see, I used to watch him. Never gave himself time to eat. Never had a penny in the house. All went in rent and leather. How he lived so long, I don't know. And why did he work so much? Because he had taken the order from the narrator and he wanted to finish it before his death. He regularly let his fire go out, so he would remain in the cold. Fire, yes, if you keep the fire, you would need money to buy coal. He was a character, but he made good boots. Yes, I said. He made good boots, and I turned and went out quickly, for I did not want that youth to know that I could hardly see. So what does he mean by this line, that I could hardly see? Because his eyes had become moist with tears, his eyes had become blurred, hazy. He felt sorry for the death of his old friend. So this is a nice story. quality, and yes, as the name suggests, so appropriateness of the title, of course, and quality versus advertisement and all that. So you will have to go through all these, and I hope I have explained it very well. And you all are attempting lengthy questions. So more or less, when you attempt these type of questions, go for the a little bit about the author and the theme. And then the summary is a part of your answer. And try to critically write your answers according to the question asked. So for this, you have to practice first. And then only you will be able to answer and get good marks. So I think I have explained it well. Still, if you have any confusion, you can always send your comments in the comment section. And for the time, let me bid you goodbye. Have a happy time.